Hello students, welcome to a lesson through the virtual training center of the Brihan Mumbai Mahanagarpalika. My name is Shraddha teacher, and in this lockdown period, since we are not able to go to school children, we will be doing many lessons here online through the virtual class. So come on, let's proceed to our lesson for today. So children, the lesson for today will be a lesson in standard 8th. Subject, as you know, is English, which I always teach you. And today's lesson will be a story. It will be a poem, and the name of the story is The Plate of Gold. So now, whenever I introduce any lesson to you children, I always tell you that this is going to be a story, this is going to be a lesson in prose, this is going to be a lesson in poetry. But today I said this is going to be a poem also, and it is going to be a story also. So now, what is this? Is it different from the other poems that we have learnt? So this is a poem definitely, but this poem is called as a narrative. Okay, so now let us see the name of the poem once again. The name of the poem is Plate of Gold, and like I told you, it is a story, but nevertheless, it is a poem as well. And it is a poem which is narrative in nature. So that means if this poem is narrative, there are other poems which are of different types. That means poetry can be written in different ways or forms. And all these different forms or ways have got different names. Okay? Now, in the younger classes, when you were in the lower classes, you might have learned a lot of poems without trying to understand to which group or category they belong to. Alright, so today before we go to the poem and we read the poem and try to understand the meaning of the poem, let us try and see what are the different types of poems which are written in the English language. And when I explain the type of poem to you, try to recall whether you have learnt this kind of a poem in your younger classes, or have you done it when you were in the 4th standard, 5th standard. Just try to recall. Okay, so the first type of poem here is a limerick. Alright, now children, there are more than 20-25 varieties of poems, but we are not going to look at all of them. We are just going to touch upon two or three types of poems which come as part of our English syllabus in our textbooks. Okay, so the first kind of poem that we have learnt is a limerick. Some people also call it as a limerick. So now, what is a limerick? It is a 5-line poem. So limericks always have got 5 lines, and there is a typical kind of rhyme also to the poem. That is, line number 1, 2 and 5 have got the same rhyme scheme, and then rhyme number 3 and line number 4 have got the same line scheme. Okay, so limerick is a 5-line poem which has got a typical rhyming scheme, the same rhyming scheme. So whichever limerick you pick up, the lines will be different, but the scheme, rhyme scheme, will be the same. Let us look at an example to make this idea better to you. So the main point here is it is a 5-line poem. So see this poem, very easy poem, very interesting to read also. So let me read it, and then you will realize what the rhyme scheme is. It is already written there. So what is a limerick, mother? It's a form of verse, said brother. So see, mother, brother, the sound is rhyming there, it is the same. In which lines 1 and 2, so here you have another sound, oo, the oo sound at the end. In which lines 1 and 2 rhyme with 5 when it's through. So see, you had the oo sound in the third line, and again you have the oo sound at the end of the fourth line. So the third line and the fourth line here rhyme with each other. And in the last line, and 3 and 4 rhyme with each other. So see, the mother rhymes with the word brother, which rhymes with the word other. So you have the rhyme scheme in this poem, which goes as AA, BB, A. Okay, so this is a limerick. So now, can you think of any limerick that you have learnt when you were in your lower classes? Think. Okay, this is a small assignment for you. Try to find out and remember the name of those limericks also. Let us go to the next kind of poem that we must have learned, and that is a ballad. So now, what is a ballad? A ballad is a song, or it is a song-like poem that tells a story. Now, there is a very, you can say, a lot of similarity between the kind of poem that we are going to learn today, that is a narrative, and a ballad. But there is a difference. A ballad is like a song, so it might have rhyming words towards the end. Okay? And the word ballad originally is derived from the old French word, which means it's a dancing song. So, ballads are usually set to dance. So, dancers, people dance on ballads. So, this is the second kind of poem that we're talking about today. And then we have one more kind of poem, which is called as the lyric poem or the lyrical poem. So, what is a lyrical poem? A lyrical poem is generally short. Just like the limerick had 5 lines, lyrical poems are also short poems. But they express deep and personal feelings. And lyrical poems may also be sung, or they may be accompanied by music. That is, a person can either sing the lyrical poems, or you could also have music to support the lyrical poems. Okay, but may not also, not compulsory. So these are some kind of poems. We also have other kind of poems called as elegies, etc. Okay. After all this now, we are going to talk about the poem that we are going to study today. And what kind of poem is that? It is a narrative. But before going to a narrative, let us look at this particular exercise which is given in your textbook. Now, this is a poem which is called as a poem with a rhyme. That is a poem in which there is a particular rhyme scheme. Okay, you can also call it as a lyrical poem. So see, they have asked you to read the poem below and fill in the gaps, choosing appropriate pairs of rhyming words to make them meaningful. Now, if you open your textbook, children, you will see that in your textbook, the words or the pairs of words are given to you in the bracket just after this poem. So now I want you to pause the video here and refer to your textbook and try to figure out which words or which pair of words will fit in which lines over here. Okay, so take a few minutes, pause this video, go to your textbook and figure out the answer, and then come back and check with the answers which I'm giving you now. So what is the name of this poem? It is Little Things. Little drops of water, little drops of sand make the mighty ocean and the pleasant land. Thus the little minutes, humble though they be, make the mighty ages of eternity. Little deeds of kindness, little words of love, make this earth an Eden like the heaven above. So can you see here? There is a lot of a rhyme here in this particular poem. Sand rhymes with land. Bee rhymes with eternity. Love rhymes with above. So this particular poem, children, it is called as a poem with rhyme. Now the poem that we are going to talk about in today's class or in today's video is called as a narrative, and narrative poems are usually in the form of a story. Okay, so a narrative poem is a poem that tells a story. Now this particular narrative poem will have all the elements of a story. So when you read a story, children, what are the various aspects of a story? So there are characters in the story, there are people in the story, there is a setting in the story. Setting means some stories are based in villages, some stories are based in cities. Okay, there is a plot. There is a plot means there is a real, you can say, what is happening in the story is told to you. So there is a plot, there is a point of view, there is a theme. So you have stories for children, stories for women, all right, stories with moral, etc. So, in the same way, a narrative poem is a poem that tells a story. But Like in the previous video, we saw that there is a particular rhyme to this particular poem, isn't it? But in a narrative, you will see that there is no rhyme. Okay, the lines, they do not rhyme with each other at all. So, narrative poems are also called as poems written in free verse. So, this is one more type of poem. Poems written in free verse. So, free means what? Free, something which doesn't have any conditions, something which does not have any limitations. And verse means words. Alright, so come on, let's see what a free verse is. So, narrative poems are usually written in a style called as the free verse. So, today along with reading and understanding the poem, The Plate of Gold, I also want you to get a lot of knowledge in general about poetry in English. Okay, so let us look at the free verse now. So, what is a free verse, children? Like I just told you, free means something which doesn't have any limitations, and verse means words. So, a free verse is that poetry that doesn't follow any specific patterns in rhythm, in rhyme scheme, or line length also. Now, in other poems, you will see if the first line has got 5 or 6 words, the second line will also have 5 or 6 words. But in a free verse, there is no line length. In the first line, you can write just 2 words, and in the next line, you can write 20 words. Okay, that is why it is called free verse. Free verse may contain rhyme, but they are not used in a prescribed manner. So rhymes, where do rhymes occur in the lines in the poem, children? They occur towards the end of the lines. Here also you might find some rhyming words, but they are not used in the manner in which it is used in other poems. Alright, so this is the meaning of a free verse. Unless and until you see an example of a free verse, this might not be clear to you. So come on, here is the example. So the name of this free verse poem is Revenge. Okay, so when I find out who took the last cookie. Now the spelling of cookie here is incorrect, children. The spelling of cookie is C-O-O-K-I-E. Now since it is a ready-made picture, this is the spelling. I want you to make a note of it. So, when I found out who took the last cookie out of the jar and left me a bunch of stale, old, messy crumbs, I'm going to take me a handful and crumb up someone's bed. Can you see? Does it sound like a poem at all? Is there any rhyme scheme? It looks like someone has written a paragraph and then he has broken it up into parts and presented it as like a. Okay, so I hope now the idea or the concept of a free verse is clear to you. So now we will go and read our poem and I will try and explain the meaning of the poem to you. Now children, since we already know that this poem is in the form of a story and stories are usually long. Okay, so this is a long poem. So, I will explain it to you in the best possible manner that we have within this time frame. Okay? If there is any part of this lesson which is left, we will try and do it in the next video. So, before going to the poem, let's see who has written the poem, who's the poet. So, the poet of this particular poem is James Henry Leigh Hunt. He is also known as Leigh Hunt. His short name, we call him as Leigh Hunt. He was an English critic, an essayist and a poet. But in spite of being an English critic and essayist, this poem is set in the famous, you can say, holy town of Banaras or Varanasi, as we know it. Okay? And this poem has also got a moral to it. We will discuss it after we read and understand the poem. So come on, let's go to the poem. I will read it line by line. So one day there fell in great Banaras temple court a wondrous plate of gold whereon these words were writ. Now here writ means written. To him who loveth best, a gift from heaven. So there was a temple and in the temple court, court means courtyard. One day they fell a great plate of gold, a wondrous, mother, beautiful plate of gold fell in the temple courtyard. On it, it was written that this plate belongs to the person who loves the best. Thereat, the priests made proclamation, at the midday hour each day, let those assemble who for virtue deem their right to heaven's gift the best, and we will hear the deeds of mercy done, and so adjudge. So the priests, now they had to hand it over. Okay, this was a gift from heaven. So they said, every day at 12 o'clock in the noon, that is midday, all those people who claim that we are, that I am the person for whom this plate has come down from heaven, they can come here and they can declare what all they have done and how they have been merciful and how they deserve the plate. And then we will make our judgment and we will decide who deserves to have this plate the best. So hence the drama started. And then you will see there the news ran swift as light and soon from every quarter came. Now you notice here, this is a free verse. The first line has got only two words and the next line has got so many words. Okay, so now everywhere the news spread. Everywhere, swift as light means like lightning, the news spread everywhere. And from every corner of the place, people started coming. Who started coming? People from all walks of life, nobles and munshis, hermits, scholars, holy men, and all renowned for gracious or for splendid deeds. So all those people who were known for their gracious and splendid deeds, like the nobles, the munshis, the hermits, the scholars, everyone started rushing towards the temple in order to claim the plate, golden plate. Meanwhile, the priest in solemn council sat and heard. And what was the duty of the priests? To sit and listen seriously. Solemn council means to seriously sit and listen to what all each person had to say, what each had done to merit best the gift of heaven. It was a duty of the priest to play the judge now. Okay? So for a year, the claimants came and went. Now this drama went on for a year. And then you will see that at last, after a patient weighing of the worth of all, the priest bestowed the plate of gold on one who seemed the largest lover of the race, whose whole estate within the year had been parted among the poor. So, after listening to so many people, now you must have all seen many reality shows on television. Okay, for example, you have reality singing shows in which people come one by one, they sing, and then the judges, they sit and they listen to all the singers, and finally in the end they decide, yes, this is the one who deserves the trophy. In the same way, after listening to so many people patiently for one entire year, finally the priest decided that the person who has donated his entire estate, means all his property, to the poor within a year is the person who deserves this gift from heaven. So let us see whether he was successful in taking the gift home. This man, all trembling with joy, advanced to take the golden plate, when lo, at his fingers' first touch, it changed to basest lead. All stood aghast. But when the hapless claimant dropped it clanging on the floor, heaven's guerdon was again transformed to shining gold. So what happened? A very sad thing happened. The man was extremely happy that in favor of so many people had tried to acquire the gift from heaven, but he was a selected one. He was a chosen one. He went, and as soon as he took the plate in his hand, it changed to lead. That is, it completely changed its qualities. Gold is something which is very expensive, and lead is something which is least expensive. So it changed to lead, and he was aghast. Aghast means he was horrified. He was, you can say, shocked. Okay? So see, everyone was shocked because a plate of gold, it changed to a plate of lead. So it meant that this is not the person who deserves to receive this plate. The hunt then continued So let's see what happens in the poem next. So far, another 12 months sat the priests and judged. Thrice they awarded, thrice did heaven refuse the gift. So three times this happened. Three times they gave it to a person thinking that he was deserving. But all the three times, heavens refused that no, this is not the person who deserves this gift. Meanwhile, a host of poor, maimed beggars in the street lay all about the temple gate in hope to move that love whereby each claimant hoped to win the gift, and well for them it was if gold be charity. For every pilgrim to the temple gate praised God that love might thus approve itself before the test, and so coins rained freely in the outstretched hands, but none of those who gave so much as turned to look into the poor sad eyes of them that begged. Now see, what happened was, now it continued for another 12 months. Again the priests sat and again they started judging. Alright, now whenever you go to any religious place, children, whether it is a temple, whether it is a mosque, whether it is a church, you will see that there are a lot of poor people, you know, people who are a little not good in life. Okay, who do not have enough money, who do not have the capacity to work, they tend to beg outside the holy places. Alright, so now people who come to the holy places, they sometimes in the hope that when you help the poor, God is pleased. So in that hope, they also give them money. They give them things to eat. So here also, everyone who was coming to claim the plate was praising God, and they were freely giving money to the people who were begging, but they did not even bother to look at these people. So it was just in the form of a formality. Okay, just because they were sitting outside the temple, these people, it was like they were doing it as an obligation. No one turned to even look at these poor souls. So were they able to win the plate of gold then? Let's see. So, and now the second year had almost passed, but still the plate of gold by whomsoever touched was turned to lead. So 2 years passed, but still there was no person who could retain the quality of the plate when held in their hands. Okay, anyone who was touching the plate of gold, the plate was changing to lead. That means they were not fit enough, they were not worthy enough to accept the gift from heaven. At length there came a simple peasant, not aware. A peasant is a person who is a farmer, who farms, who works on the farms for a living. Now there came a simple peasant who was not even aware, he did not even know that there is this kind of a competition going on here, of that strange contest for the gift of God, to pay a vow within the temple. As he passed along the line of shriveled beggars, all his soul was moved within him to sweet pity, and the tears welled up and trembled in his eyes. Okay, so as soon as he came near the temple, he saw all these poor people sitting there and their hands were all shriveled. Okay, we will see the meanings of some difficult words later after reading the poem. Shriveled means what? Shrunk, dried up. Okay, and as soon as he saw them, tears welled up in his eyes. That is, his eyes were full of tears. And then, now by the temple gate, there lay a poor, sore creature, blind and shunned by all. So there was a poor person who was sore. Maybe he was suffering from leprosy. He had a lot of, wounds on his body. He was blind also. And because of his appearance, people had shunned him. Shunned him means people used to never go to him. People used to try to run away from him. So there lay a poor, sore creature, blind and shunned by all. But when the peasant came and saw the sightless face means his face was so bad. There were so many sores and there were so many wounds on his face that he could not see people. And people also could not bear to look at his face. But when the peasant saw him, what happened is, the trembling and maimed hand, he could not pass. He could not just walk past him. So he knelt. He sat down and took both palms in his hand and softly said, O thou, my brother, bear thy troubles bravely. God is good. He said, you're having a lot of troubles now, I know, but bear it bravely because God is good. He is merciful and he will deliver you from this pain. Then he arose and walked straight away across the court and entered where they wrangled of their deeds of love. What is wrangling, children? Sometimes you will see people going and shopping. When the shopkeeper says that this, you can say, you suppose you're talking about a pen, that this pen is for 100 rupees. You will see people saying, no, 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 give it for 50, give it for 20, give it for 30. This is called wrangling. Okay? So inside people were wrangling and they were saying, no, no, I am better, he is better. So this kind of thing, competition, contest was happening inside the temple. Alright? So he walked straight and he did not bother about what all is happening there and before the priests. Okay? So here the people were wrangling before the priest because they wanted the plate of gold. But this man did not bother and he did not even look at them. While he listened sadly, then had turned away. But something moved the priests who held the plate of gold to beckon to the peasant. He listened to the people and he shook his head and he said, oh my God, these people are making such a show of the good deeds that they have done. And he moved away. But the priests called him. Okay, they felt that there is something about this person. So the priest called him. So he came, not understanding, and obeyed, and stretched his hand and took the sacred vessel. Lo, it shone. So did it stop shining? Not at all. It shone with thrice its former luster and amazed them all. So it did not become lead. On the contrary, it started shining thrice the amount that it was shining before. And everyone was amazed. Alright? Son, cried the priest, rejoice, the gift of God is thine. Thine means yours. Thou lovest best. And all made answers, it is well. And one by one departed. But the peasant knelt and prayed, bowing his head above the plate. With o'er his soul like morning streamed the love of God. So you see, I told you this is a long, long poem which tells you an entire story. So why did the plate start shining brighter? Because this person, he did not make a show of his love. He did not make a show of his charity. He really was merciful from the bottom of his heart. That means when you are trying to help someone, when you are trying to be charitable, do it with a pure and a kind heart. And not because you want some benefit from it. Alright? So this is the entire poem, children. So now we will try and do the remaining exercises that are there in this lesson in the next video. Alright? We have taken up a lot of time just reading and explaining the poem. So what have we done in this part, children? We have seen what are the different kinds of poems. Okay? We saw that poems can be lyrical, they can be free verse, and then we discussed that this particular poem that we have read right now, it is a narrative. Now what is a narrative? A narrative is a poem which is a long one. It is a very long poem and it tries to tell you a story also. So what did we see here? We saw that this particular poem is about a gift from heaven. Okay, one day suddenly there was a golden plate which appeared in the courtyard in a temple in Banaras. Alright, and then it was declared that the person who has got the most beautiful heart, that is the person who loves humanity the most, will be the owner of the plate. And then they started a long race for winning, or you can say a long contest for winning the a plate, which went on for 2 years. Okay, and in this meantime there were 3 people who were given the plate of gold, but the moment they took it in their hand, sadly the plate turned to lead. That means they were not deserving. Okay, and then we saw how this person, or this peasant who did not have any intention of contesting for the plate of gold, won it. Okay, children. So this was the poem. Now let us meet next time to continue with the other exercises in this lesson. So children, wasn't that a wonderful video? And did you enjoy watching it? So if you want to watch more such videos in future, then please like this video and also subscribe to our channel, the MCGM Portal for Education, and also hit the bell button so that you get notified whenever I upload a new video here. Thank you so much for now. Let's meet again soon.